about the mysterious light that came in. Alone and forsaken, my faith and my man, till an angel came down.
Arizona was not unknown territory to William Branham. As a young child, it was the land of his dreams. In 1927, a Jeffersonville family named Francisco needed help to make the long drive from Indiana to Arizona. After nearly 2 weeks on the road, they arrived in Phoenix, where Billy soon found work on a ranch. Only a few months later, in 1929, he was called back to Jeffersonville for the funeral of his brother Edward. Many years later, on January 4, 1963, William Branham, a prophet of God, moved his entire family to the desert region near Tucson. He too knew he would be going into the wilderness, for God had called his end-time prophet Elijah to a time of communion.
God showed him a vision about a bridge being built, later on was fulfilled.
In 1927, Billy went to Arizona to satisfy his personal dream and to escape the squalor and poverty of his boyhood home. Perhaps he was also running from God. 35 years later, nearly at the end of his life, he moved his family to Arizona to obey the will of God. Brother Branham often wondered why he had to go to the backside of the desert. He found the answer in the Bible, in the lives of Moses and the Apostle Paul. All three were called into the desert to meet God and to receive a deeper revelation of His Word and His will. Our prayer is that all who watch this DVD will have a better understanding of the monumental events that occurred in the mountainous desert terrain surrounding Tucson, Arizona.
There's a doubt in your mind what I've said. Don't take it from me. Check it out, the Word. With an open heart, God will show that it's plain. That will.
Even as a child, there was something in the young William Branham that identified with the life of an outdoorsman. This set him apart from the other children. Though he loved the stories about the mighty Tarzan of the Apes, and I paused to look on the web and found Tarzan fighting a gorilla and Tarzan in combat with a lion, and all these various things showing the strength of the mighty outdoorsman. But even though he liked Tarzan and told stories about how he copied that, his special love was for the novels by Zane Grey. And Zane Grey was the one that focused on the life in the West. And here we have the Riders of the Purple Sage by Zane Grey and the Man of the Forest by Zane Grey with the rifle over his shoulder, and the Lone Star Ranger about the Texas Ranger and his standing against the enemy. And then the Heritage of the Desert with the enemy, with the Indians out in the desert. And this no doubt had a tremendous effect on the young man. And the Southwest today is somewhat even wild yet. There's still cougars and lions out there. And then at the age of 12, with a borrowed pen and paper, this longing for the deep Southwest turned into a very prophetic poem.
I had a little poem I wrote, something like this. Now I just think I was only about 12 years old. And standing up there today looking up that canyon and thinking that lion will be sitting right here in this dinner room looking out the window, in a glass window. I was thinking of a little poem. I went back and picked it up, something like this. Just think how God, do you believe God's in all inspiration? God has to write a song? You believe God's in songs? Jesus said so. He referred back to David. Don't you know what David said in the Psalms? You know, has not, look at the very crucifixion. David sang it. In the 22nd Psalm, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? All my bones, they stare at me, they pierce my hands and my feet. You know, and that was a song. Psalms is a song. And in this poetry, just watch how it come to pass. Sitting there, a little old kid with a barred sheet of paper, I said, I am lonesome, oh so lonesome, far that far away southwest, where the shadows fall the deepest over the mountain crest. I can see a lurking coyote all around the purple haze. I can hear a lobo hollering down where the longhorns graze. And somewhere up a canyon, I can hear a lion whine in that far-off Catalina Mountains at the Arizona line. 40 years later, I'm sitting right there at that canyon, that lion looking me in the face. Oh, God. There's a land beyond the river somewhere, friends. It's got to be there. See, there's too much speaking of it.
This haunting pull to a destiny in the West continued in this young prophet's life. In a hunting accident with a fellow young hunter, his legs were nearly blown off by a shotgun. Laying in a pool of his own blood in a hospital bed, he seemed to be again in the West. A huge cross appeared, and then a sequence developed that ended up producing Christ. While telling his own life story, he speaks of how emotionally low he was at the loss of his baby Sharon Rose and the death of his wife Hope. Exhausted from work, he came home, fell asleep. There was a prairie schooner, an old covered wagon with a wheel broken, symbolizing his own broken family. There also was another surprise, one of the prettiest blonde-headed, blue-eyed young ladies he has ever seen, and as he walked up to her, she called him Dad. What is this? Near the end of 1962, again, the prairie schooner symbolism was used with his family all loaded and ready to go. He snapped the reins for the lead horse to head west, and then the schooner became the family station wagon. It was time to forsake all he had called home in Jeffersonville, Indiana, and move west. Dream is becoming reality. Brother Branham spoke about all this in the sermon, Is This the Sign of the End, Sirs, December 30th, 1962. He shared with his congregation something great was about to happen. Six different people at Branham Tabernacle had all shared their dream to Brother Branham. They so linked together, he felt he dare not even tell each of them what it meant. There were six dreams, and now the seventh is a vision to William Branham himself. First, a formation of little bitty birds, only an inch or so long. They looked so battle-scarred, he called them little veterans. And then bigger birds, doves, and then coming from eternity in the twinkling of an eye, a group of angels came to meet him. A further, an ongoing, an advance in the ministry is at hand.
All of you seen it around the world. You don't go to sleep standing on a platform talking to people. You hear me go into visions and come back when I'm riding in a car with you anywhere else and tell you things that's going to happen and never fails. Never have. Has anybody ever seen it fail?
No.
It can't fail. It won't fail as long as it's God. Notice, right on the platform, thousands before, tens of thousands of people, even in other languages that I can't even speak, still it don't fail. See? God. Now, in this vision, or as I was speaking, I looked and I saw a strange thing. Now, it seemed like that my little son Joseph was by my side. I was talking to him. Now, if you'll watch the vision real close, you'll see why Joseph was standing there. And I looked, and there was a big bush. And on this bush, in a constellation of birds, little bitty birds, about a half inch long and a half inch high. They were little veterans. Their little feathers was beat down. And there was about two or three on the top limb, six or eight on the next limb, and 15 or 20 on the next limb, coming down in the shape of a pyramid.
And those little fellows, little messengers, and they were pretty well worn out. And they were watching eastward, and I was at Tucson, Arizona, in the vision. For it made it so purpose that he didn't want me to fail to see where it was at. I was picking a sand burr off of me from the desert. And I said, now, I know this is a vision, and I know that I'm at Tucson. And I know that them little birds there represent something. And they were watching eastward. And all of a sudden, they taken an ocean to fly, and away they went eastward. And as soon as they left, a constellation of larger birds came. They looked like doves, sharp-pointed wings, kind of a gray color, a little lighter color than what these first little messengers was. And they were coming eastward swiftly. And no sooner than they got out of my sight, I turned again to look westward, and there it happened. There was a blast that actually shook the whole earth. I don't miss this. And you on tape, be sure you get this right. First, a blast. And I thought it sounded like a sound barrier, what you call it when planes cross the sound and the sound comes back to the earth. You shook like roared everything. Then it could have been a great clap of thunder, lightning. I didn't see the lightning. I just heard that great blast that went forth that sounded like it was south from me, towards Mexico. But it shook the earth. And when it did, I was still looking westward and way off into eternity. I saw a constellation of something coming. It looked like that it might have been little dots. There could have been no less than five and not more than seven. But they were in the shape of a pyramid, like these messengers coming. And when it did, the power of Almighty God lifted me up to meet Him. And I can see it. It's never left me. 8 days is gone. And I can't forget it yet. I never had anything to bother me like that has. My family will tell you. I could see those angels, those shaped back wings, traveling faster than sound could travel. They come from eternity in a split like the twinkling of an eye. Not enough to bat your eye, just a twinkle. They were there. I didn't have time to count. I didn't have time to worry. Then just look. Mighty ones, great, powerful angels, snow white, wings setting heads, and they were pew, pew. And when it did, I was caught up into this pyramid of constellations.
As an old saying is often heard, go west, young man, go west. And this was even rehearsed into the ears of William Branham by a young fortune teller type lady who had told him, you'll never be successful in the East. Your destiny lies in the West. In fulfilling this ministry, it had been shown that there would be three stages of this ministry. The depiction was related to fishing. As Jesus said to Peter, I'll make thee fishers of men. So he was pulling in fish, so it became known in the ministry as the three pulls. First, in the laying on of his hands, if it was a spirit disease, a series of bumps would rise on the back of the prophet's hand and actually move about. In seeing this, the patient's faith would rise at this supernatural demonstration. Then Brother Branham could call the name of the disease and the outcome. The bumps would disappear as the disease left the patient's. Then there was a second pull. He was told, be sincere, and it will come to pass that you will know the very secrets of their hearts, problems, illnesses, hidden sins. Nothing was undercover. Anyone with any sense could know that only God could know these things, names, addresses, what you were last praying about, even the position you were in when you were praying, never failing. The third pull was shown, but switched from a fishing symbolism to the vision of a huge tent or cathedral. A long line of people entered individually into a small room off on one side of the platform. Whatever went on inside was a great mystery, even to the people as they came out healed and made whole, praising God. What happened, I don't know. The third pull manifestation was soon to be seen as a demonstration of the power of the spoken word. If you say to this mountain, the Bible says, healing, deliverance, salvation, control of weather, creation, restoration of life, the infallible God showing that he can work through fallible men because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Once more came a further unfolding of this mysterious third pull as a prophet was kneeling in prayer up in Sabino Canyon. From nowhere came a beautiful sword into his uplifted hand. Brother Branham remarked, "It fit my hand perfectly." The voice then spoke out, "This is the king's sword." Well, there was only one, the king, and that's God. And his sword is his word. Placed in the hand of William Branham? No, not really. Placed in the hand of Elijah, the anointing of the seventh angel of Revelation 10:7.
This is the spot where Brother Branham received the sword in his hand. Brother Green and a couple of other brothers came to find it. And when they got to this spot, they just didn't know what to do, and so they decided to pray. And Brother Green says that while he was praying, he had his hands out like this, and he felt the hand, his right hand, begin to get warm, realizing that the sun was hitting his hand, and right through the horn there of the saddle, or the eye of the needle, the light came shining through, and he struck his hand, and he remembered that Brother Branham said that the sword was glistening in the sun. And at the time of the year when Brother Branham was here, the rest of the canyon is enshadowed with darkness because of the winter season. And this spot right here is the only spot that receives light in the early hour, morning hours.
I went west wondering what was going to happen. One day I got a call from the Lord. I told my wife, I said, "Honey, my work is over." I didn't know. I said, "God's probably finished with me now, and I'll be going home. You go get with Billy. Take the children. God will make a way for you somehow. Go on and live true to God. See if the children get through school. Raise them in the admonition of God." She said, "Bill, you don't know that's true." I said, "No, but a man couldn't survive that." One morning, the Lord woke me up and said, "Get up there, Sabine Shannon." I took a piece of paper and my Bible. The wife said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I don't know. I'll tell you when I come back." I went up in the canyon, climbed plumb up where the eagles was flying around. I was watching some deer standing there. I knelt down to pray and raised up my hands, and a sword struck my hand. I looked around, I thought, "What's that? I'm not beside myself. Here's that sword in my hand, bright, shiny, glistening in the sun." I said, "Now there's not people in miles of me way up here in this canyon. Where could that come from?" I heard a voice said, "That's the king's sword."
Amen.
I said, "A king knights a man with a sword." The voice come back said, "Not a king's sword, but the king's sword."
Amen.
The word of the Lord. I said, "Fear not. It's only the third pull. It's the vindication of your ministry."
You remember on the tape, "Church, what time it is?" I've quoted over. Remember, something's fixing to take place major. Now it's made the whole nation testify to it. Every newspaper on the Associated Press and one of our leading magazines and everything else testifying all over yet. But what a privileged people. A privileged people. It's Christians. To know that in this dark hour when there's no hope, according to science, there's an atomic bomb waiting for them. And no hope in our organizations ever getting together, they're consolidating with the mark of the beast. And when all of our hope that way is gone in our economy of our Christian fellowship amongst the organizations, it's hiding up into Catholicism, which will be a mark of the beast in the Confederation Church. But in those who love God and are looking for reality, that the very God who made the promise in the Bible spreads it before our faith and makes the church and the people in science and magazines and everything recognize that he's still God and can tell the truth. What a time. Then in Sabinia Canyon that morning, praying and wondering what would happen, holding my hands out to God up on top of that mountain, that sword dropped into my hand with a pearl handle and this guard over it and a long blade about 3 foot long and glistening like hot metal or like chrome, razor sharp. And I didn't know what it was. And I said, I'm afraid of these things. And just then a voice spoke that shook the canyon, that this is the sword of the Lord. And the sword of the Lord is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
For the word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword.
Amen.
In the spring of 1963, Brother Branham, Fred Southman, and Gene Norman went to hunt javelina in the Sunset Mountains. And I find it extremely interesting that the gospel has traveled from the east to the west, and just as the sunlight travels from the east to the west. If we go any further west than the United States, we're back east again. And then here we are with a finalized message to the Gentile people coming in the west of the United States, where the sun on the gospel is setting in a state that has a symbol of a setting sun for a flag and on a mountain called Sunset Mountain. God is telling us all around, time is ending. Going hunting 40 miles northeast of Tucson, they were just exactly in the vision as stated back in Jeffersonville. As the three drove into the cove where they were to set up camp for the duration of the hunt, Gene Norman testifies that Brother Branham told him, the angels have been waiting here for us all week. That's on a testimony tape recorded by George Smith of Gene Norman. In a repeat performance of Speed, seen in the vision in Jeffersonville, spoken about in Is This the Sign of the Inserts? And with the boom of an airplane breaking the sound barrier, seven angels came to their appointment with the prophet. Brother Branham was caught up in their midst and commissioned to return to Jeffersonville, where he would be given by Christ the mysteries hidden under the seven seals of Revelations chapter 6. Pictures of the cloud formed by the angels, too high, they say, to be real, was taken from several different angles around the state and confirmed its unprecedented altitude. The most famous of them appeared in Life magazine on May 17, 1963 issue. Brother Branham explains the vision of the angels and this visit in again, Is This the Sign of the End, Sir?
I believe he told me Brother Hickerson just took this out of the magazine, put it on my desk back there. That is that constellation of angels that's in the magazine that was spoke of. See the pyramid shape? Look at this one on this side, the pointed wing coming with his chest out like that on my right-hand side as I spoke from this same pulpit months and months and months ago. See? There it is. And Look or Life magazine has it, the May issue, May the 17th, I believe it. Is that right? May the 17th issue. Mrs. Woods was telling me today that many called her and asked, that's in the May issue, May the 17th. It's a mysterious cloud. The cloud is 26 miles high and 30 miles across. And that's what we were speaking of here. And that's where the angel of the Lord came down and shook the place, and the whole sound louder. I know there's one man, I think Brother Southman, I seen him a while ago somewhere. He's here, he was standing, yeah, right back here. He was standing near when it happened. I guess I wasn't too far from him. I just seen him, tried to wave to him, only I had his binoculars, that the animals in which we were hunting had wasn't on this hill, and I went on the other hill. I found them the day before and told them where to go to. And I went over here where if they come this way, I would just shoot up in the air and run them back that way so that they could get their animal. So javelina is what it was. And so I went over on this side, and there wasn't on either side. I seen Brother Fred walk out, and it wasn't there. He went back, and Brother Norman went over the hill, and I turned, went down in a little chasm and come up
just by myself, about a mile and a half through some real rugged country. And I was sitting down and was just looking around. It's getting up in the day, and I was picking those, what we call their goat headers. It's something like a burr. Picked them off of my trouser leg, just exactly the same kind that I saw myself doing when I was here telling you about the vision 6 months before it happened. And I said, that's strange. And look how perfect north I am of Tucson. Kind of northeast makes Tucson. You remember I said a little southwest. And I said, that's strange. And I was looking at the burr like this, picking them off of my, many of them, off of my trouser legs. If you've never been there, that's a desert country. It isn't like this at all. About 20 times brighter. There's no trees and things like there is here. It's just cactus and sand. So I just looking at it like that. I just raised my eyes up, and about, I'd say, a half a mile from me, I saw a whole herd of javelina coming out on the end where they're eating some fillery. And I thought, now, if I can just get Brother Fred and Brother Norman to there, that's just the place. And the evening before, the Holy Spirit was so tremendous in the camp that he was telling me things that had happened and had taken place. I had to get up and walk away from the camp. And then that next morning, I went up there, and I said, now, if I can get to Brother Fred, I'll get him around this mountain, which is about a mile this way. I had to go about 2 miles or better to pick him up, maybe three. Back this way down this, what we call hogback, come up like this, up top of these rugged, jagged mountains, and run down this way, cut across and come over and go down in this direction and pick him up. And then you have to go plumb to the bottom of the hill to get Brother Norman, which had probably been about 4 or 5 miles, then get back, and I was going to put a little piece of Kleenex. I was going to hang on a piece of the mesquite there so I could point myself to which ridge to go out when I come back. And I just come up over a little ridge where there's a lot of jagged rock, and there's a deer trail come down the other side about 40, 50 yards beneath the cliff. It's about, it was up in the day, I say 8 o'clock or 9, would you think, something like that, Brother Fred, maybe 9 o'clock, something. I run over on this side quickly to keep the javelinas from seeing me. They're a wild boar, you know, and they're pretty scary. So I went over the hill this way and started running up the hill and just run along in a little, what we call a dog trot. And all of a sudden, the whole country just rung out. I never heard such a terrific blast. Just shucking, the rocks rolled, and I felt like I must have jumped 5 feet off the ground, looked like it. Just scared me. I thought, oh my, I thought I'd gotten shot, that somebody, I had on a black hat, I thought they might have thought it was a javelina running up the mountain, somebody had shot me. It went so loud, got on me like that. Then all at once, something said, look up. There it was. Then he told me, he said, open any of those seven seals, turn home. So here I come. I met Brother Fred and Brother Norman about an hour later when I found them. They were excited and talking about it. And there it is. Amen. And science says that it's impossible for any kind of a mist or anything to get that high, fog, vapor. See, it'll only go just, I wouldn't know. When we go overseas, we travel 9,000 feet. That's above the storms. That's approximately about 4 miles. And say, let's say, maybe it's 15 miles. Because you can't get no more vapor. But this is 26 miles. And she hung there all day. They don't know what it is. But thank the Lord. Amen. We do. Amen. Thank you, Brother Hickerson. Keep it on my desk.
Brother Branham often stated that if we observe things natural, they often are a reflection of things spiritual. So by seeing what we can see, we can understand things we cannot see. It's quite common that if the women in the church are not dressed in the modesty that's shown to us in biblical standards, so they're off the word, then there's a good chance that church is off the word. If the women in the church are dressing worldly, there's just a very good chance that the church itself is worldly. So along this same principle, it was in the fall of 1963, Brother Branham saw a striking example of this as he was sitting in a JCPenney department store, Tucson, Arizona, sitting in a chair near the escalator, waiting for his wife, doing her shopping. Brother Branham noticed several women riding up and down on the escalator, and they were dressed immodestly, but he especially noticed the green eyeshadow on one woman. It reminded him of a vision he had experienced when he was 14 years old, yet an unsaved boy, possibly dying. He found himself descending into hell. Some haunting-looking women were coming to meet him. Not pleasant. Yet here he was in downtown Tucson, seeing what he had seen 40 years before, and it dawned on him, just as heaven and eternity are blending into this age, which is yet in time, these women indicate that hell is spilling over into this dimension also. The two powers are both on display. Let me repeat that. This experience led him to the shocking conclusion, just as God was displaying his holy glory and power through the revealing of the Son of Man, Satan was revealing himself more and more through his servants. In the message, Souls That Are in Prison Now, he brought out how that Jesus descended and preached to the souls who were in prison that repented not in the long days of the suffering of Noah, but now had no ability to repent. And after his J.C. Penney experience, he could but ask himself, what if this is the third pull to the totally lost? Is this an indication that the day of grace is closing to the Gentiles?
And all of the majority of the shopping was downtown. They had hotels, restaurants, you know, all of the major shopping was located in the downtown area of Tucson. And it was really the main hub for just about everything. There were beginning at that time to build restaurants, you know, out towards the east side of town. There were, you know, obviously grocery stores and things like that. But the majority of the, you know, the shopping for clothing and things like that were predominantly downtown. And one of the main stores downtown was the Penney's store. And I remember the Penny store in particular as a young boy because it had an escalator. And I remember playing on the escalator, going up and down and up and down. And my mother, you know, saying, you know, don't play on the escalator, because I didn't just go down the up. I went up the down and down the, you know, and played on it. And so it was just kind of made an impression because I would be playing on it while she was doing her shopping. And as I got older, I remember going there and shopping for clothing for school, and remembered that they had these white t-shirts that we used to like as I was growing up and getting older. Downstairs on the escalator, we'd go down and to the right, they had these tables that had the men's t-shirts, the white t-shirts. And so I vividly remember that, you know, those, that escalator, and going up and down it. And even as I was older, I always remember that it was one of the few places in all of Tucson that had an escalator at that time. And when they started building the malls, you know, around town, then of course some of the stores moved from the downtown area and moved into those mall areas, and then they started closing the downtown ones. And currently I believe that they've torn it all down, that area where the Penny store was, and they've replaced it with the downtown library, and there's a little park down there.
Now, I never noticed it too much until about 4 weeks ago. The wife never thought of it in this terms. About 4 weeks ago, the wife and I went down to Tucson to do some shopping. And while we were sitting, the wife, we ran downstairs, and there was a bunch of sissy-like boys, had their hair red, you know, like the women does, and bangs combed down here in front, and these real high trousers on, kind of, I guess, the beatniks or what you call them. And they were in there, and everybody's looking at them, and their heads is that big, like the women that wears these here, water head haircuts, you know. And they were down there, and a young woman come by, and she said, "What do you think about that?" I said, "Then you ought to be ashamed of yourself, if you can think that." I said, "He has just as much right to do it as you do. Neither one of you have a right." So I went upstairs, and I sat down, and when I did, there's an escalator. It was a J.C. Penney store, and the escalator bringing the people up. Well, I really turned sick at my stomach of seeing those women come up there, young, old, and indifferent, wrinkled, young, and every way, with little bitty shorts on, their filthy body, and those sexy dressed women with those great big heads like that. And here they come, And one coming right up that escalator is coming right up like that where I was sitting back in a chair, sitting there with my head down. And I turned and looked, and one of them coming up the steps was Spanish speaking to another woman. She was a white woman speaking to the Spanish woman. And when I looked, all of once I was changed. There I'd seen that before. Her eyes, you know how the women are doing now, painting their eyes just recently, like cat, you know, put it up like this, and wearing cat glasses and everything, you know, with eyes up like this, and that green stuff under their eyes, there was that thing that I seen when I was a child. There was the woman, just exactly. And I just got numb all over and began to look around, and there was those people mumbling, you know, going on about the prices and things. In the building, it looked like it. I just changed for a moment. And I looked and I thought, that's what I saw in hell. There they was, that canker. I thought because they were in hell, what made them that way, that greenish blue under their eyes. And here was these women painted with greenish blue. Just the way that vision said about 40 years ago. Okay? About 40 years ago is what it's been. I'm 54. I was 14. So about 40 years ago, that's the number anyhow of the judgment. Now, I've seen that, and I couldn't even speak to my wife when she comes. She's over there trying to get Sarah and the kids something kind of a dress or something for school. And I couldn't even speak to her. And she said, "What's the matter? Are you sick?" I said, "No. Something's just happened." Now, she don't know. She's waiting for this tape to return. I've never said it to nobody. And I thought I'd wait, as I promised, bring it to the church first. Bring it to the church. And that's my promise. And you'll realize after tonight, the reason I try to keep my promise. And I thought then, as I noticed them cankered-looking eyes on them women. There were the Spanish, the French, and Indian and white and all together, but that great big heads, you know, bushed up with that combs where they comb it back, way big, and then comes out, you know how they do it, fix it in the, like this, and then them canker looking eyes and the eyes with a paint that run back like a cat's eye. And them talking, and there I was again, standing there in J.C. Penney's store, back in hell again. I got so scared, I thought, "Lord, surely I haven't died, and you've let me come to this place after all." And there they were, making this ground like that, in that vision, like you could just barely hear it with your ears, you know, just the mumbling going on with people, and them women coming up that escalator and walking around there, and there's them green, funny-looking eyes, mournful. Wife come up, and I said, "Just let me alone with me, honey." I said, "If you don't mind, I want to go home." And she said, "Are you sick?" I said, "No. Just go ahead, honey, if you got any shopping to do." She said, "No, I'm finished." And I said, "Let me take you for the arm." See? I walked out, she said, "What's the matter?" I said, "Meaty, something happened up there." And while I was under that, I thought this. What day are we living in? Could this be the third pull? Thank you.
When God sends a message to earth, it's mercy to those who can receive it, but judgment to those who reject. All you have to do is think about Noah, and the picture becomes very clear. To spurn mercy, there nothing remains but judgment. Sadly, this is the condition of the church and the world today. February 29, 1964, the angel of the Lord spoke to Brother Branham and told him, pick up a rock and throw it in the air. As it fell back down to the ground, Brother Branham said, thus saith the Lord, you'll see something happen right away. He told his friends that within 24 hours they would see the glory of the Lord firsthand. The very next day, on March 1st, a whirlwind roared through the canyon, ascending and descending over the Brother Branham three times. The tops of the trees were chopped off, and a portion of the canyon wall was blasted away. Strangely, the rocks that fell into the campsite all had a pyramid shape on at least one side. When asked what the whirlwind represented, Brother Branham told his hunting partners this visitation was a prophetic sign of impending judgment for the west coast of America. 27 days later, on Good Friday, remember that name, that judgment began near Prince William Sound off the coast of Alaska when a 9.2 magnitude earthquake followed by a huge tsunami took the lives of 128 people, caused millions of dollars in damage. Thus saith the Lord, followed that, the judgments of God started in the earth with the Alaska earthquake and will not stop. The very next Good Friday, another earthquake struck the Seattle Olympia area in Washington, only 6.5, this time on the Richter scale. That very day of the quake, the prophet comments while preaching in Los Angeles on a message called The Choosing of a Bride. That great monster laying up yonder that flipped himself over in Alaska a few days ago threw his tail up again this morning along about down around Washington. He could head this way mighty soon.
I saw him get up from this table, and he went over, and we had a shovel leaning up against a tree. So he picked up this shovel, and he walked over to that rock, and he was shoveling dirt kind of to put the coals out, you know. And all of a sudden, we heard this whirlwind. And it was coming straight down out of the sky. And it was just screaming very loud, very loud. You could tell it wasn't anything natural. It was supernatural. But we didn't know what it was. We didn't know why or anything. And so I looked at Brother Branham. I was watching him. And he goes and he just looks up at it, pulls his hat off. And he stands there and looks right up in that. It came down about 10 feet off of the ground, right on the top of the little mesquite trees. And it was whipping those trees, just whipping them, pulling rocks out of the cliff and throwing them all over the place. And he stood there, and every eye was glued on him. And it all of a sudden went away. It went right straight back up like it came and went out of hearing. And he kind of acted as if he didn't know whether to talk about that or not. And so as he walked back over to where we were standing, he said, you know, one time God spoke to Job in a whirlwind. And that's all he said. Then later on that afternoon, then he began to talk about it being judgment striking the West Coast and so forth.
Now notice, he went in by the plan of God, foreknowledge, call of God, and the Word of God, and went in before the drought set in. Now, we know that judgment is ready to strike. Standing on the hill that day, Brother Banks Wood standing here was walking up the hill. Maybe I quote it again. So that build your faith for this prayer line is fixing to take place. next 10, 15 minutes. I was just walking ahead of Brother Banks. He was, I think he had left Sister Ruby when she was sick. And he, coming behind me, I noticed his face red. I looked back, I thought the hill might be a little hard from the pull. So I kind of slowed up, right in them deserts, right up the hills like that. Right where the angel of the Lord appeared, was heading right in that direction then, where they had appeared a few months before that. And as I went up the hill, the Spirit of God, when I turned around and looked on top of the mountain, he said, pick up that rock and say to him, thus saith the Lord. You'll see the glory of God in the next few hours. I just picked up the rock and said, Brother Banks, I don't know why. Throw it up the air and I said, thus saith the Lord, you're going to see the glory of God. He said, that meant Ruby? I said, no, I don't think it had anything to do with you, Banks, or Ruby, either one. I just think it was just saying, thus saith the Lord. Something's going to happen. And the next morning when we were standing there, many of the men, I don't know how many sitting here now, there's 12 or 14, 15 of us sitting there. All of a sudden, a minister walked up to him and he said, Brother Branham, he said, my name is so-and-so. He said, I was one of your sponsors in California. I said, I'm glad to meet you, sir. Douglas McHugh. He said, I'm glad to meet you. Shook hands with him. He said, well, now, I want to ask you a question. He said, Roy Roberson, trustee here, Brother Woods, Terry and Billy and all, Brother McAnally and I don't know who all were standing there. And he said, I want to ask you something. He said, does the Lord ever give you visions out like this? I said, yes, brother, but I come out here to kind of get away from it, to rest up. And I looked around like this and I seen a heavy-set doctor looking at him and said, Reverend McHugh, this allergy in your eye will soon put your eye out. I've doctored you for 2 years and I can do nothing about it. And I turned around to him and I said, what you asked me that for? Your doctor told you the other day that allergy was in your eye. It was middle of the day, about 11 o'clock, and he's wearing sunglasses. I said, the reason you're not wearing that because it's the sun is because of your eye. He told you you're going to lose that eye, and he started crying. So that's right. I turned to walk around again, had a shovel in my hand. And I looked, and I see him standing there looking at me, his eyes just as bright. I said, but thus saith the Lord, you're not going to lose that eye. I was hunting with him this last fall. He could see better than me and anybody in the crowd. You know? And I seen an elderly lady pull down her stocking and raise up the side of her skirt. She said, son, if you see Brother Branham, tell him to pray for my feet. And I looked down there and little tumors hanging on her feet all around. I said, your mother's a gray-headed lady, my son. You see, she told you before you left, if you see me, to have me to pray for her feet. She's got little tumors like hanging on her feet. He liked to faint. I said, that's the truth. I said, tell her not to worry. It'll be all right. I started walking around and I heard the voice of God speak, said, get out of the way quickly. Roy Roberson standing there knowing he was a veteran of the war. I put my hand on his shoulder. I said, Brother Roy, hide as quick as you can. I said, what's the matter? I said, get out of the way, hide. And I started walking around, put my shovel down, turned around, took off my hat, and here he come. Glory of God falling in a whirlwind that tore the side of the mountain out like that. It blasted and shook the place like that, cut the top of the bushes out. It's about 3 or 4 or 5 feet above my head. Went back up like a funnel like that. It blasted again, and here it come 3 times. Then when it left the 3rd time, Brother Banks came over and said, that's what you talked about. I said, yes. I said, what was it? I said, God appears in whirlwinds. I didn't know whether he wanted me to tell the people or not. And I went on and prayed a little bit. Then he told me I could tell him. I said, it's judgment striking the West Coast. Look at her today. Look what happened a few hours after that. Alaska sunk, and now the whole thing is going under. We're entering into the judgment. Mercy's been spurned. But thanks be to God, we got hidden food, spiritual food, that we're living on the goodness and mercy of the revelation of Jesus Christ in these last days, vindicating himself among his people. Hey, man, they went in. Elijah went in before the drought set in. Thank God for being in before the judgment sets in. Now's a time of coming out and going in. Getting out of those organizations, getting into Christ, of coming out and going in time for all true believers.
You will hear many times on tape people asking Brother Branham to explain all the ramifications surrounding marriage and divorce. He knew he would have to preach on it one day. But the topic is perhaps one of the most difficult subjects in the Bible, unknown to most Bible students. The varied consequences of this sticky subject matter left him in despair, sent him into deeper prayer than almost any other doctrine, for he was fully aware that many sheep in his own church were not scripturally united. with the level of understanding he had, he did not want to see all these people's families, wives, husbands, children hurt by a marital breakup. But what could he do? The Lord called Brother Branham into the mountains outside of Tucson. The angel of the Lord came down on the mountain known as Finger Rock in the form of a pulsating amber cloud. This one was not the usual, seen by prophetic eyes only. The brothers at a service station owned by Brother Welch Evans stood watching. Teachers even called the school children out of their classes to watch the fiery-looking amber cloud go up into the air and then back down to the area surrounding the prophet. Finally, the Lord had given the prophet that added revelation he felt he needed in order to preach on the subject of marriage and divorce. In the Easter Seal, preached in April 1965, "A sword in your hand," said, "go home and open those seven seals that are given." And here they are, the true mystery of marriage and divorce, the serpent seed, and all these things that's fussed about. It's "Thus saith the Lord."
Right. Yes. So, but as far as the people were concerned, so they saw him as a prophet, like the woman at the well. She said,
right.
"You know,
yeah,
thou
yeah.
art a prophet." So they saw him as a prophet, which was nice, but not enough.
Right.
Some saw him as a gifted man, and that was nice, but that wasn't enough. See, they didn't see him in the Scripture.
Right. Right.
So that group was a big group of people. Then there were other many denominational people, and they were in a state of, they were in a very difficult place in that they knew the presence of the angel of the Lord. They knew it because you could sense it, you could feel it, you yeah. couldn't get away from it. And he would speak and reveal the secrets of the hearts to the people who came up and would always say, "Is that true? Is that true?" So they were having difficulty, you know, identifying that as just a gift, and they knew that it was, you know, unusual, it was something more, but they couldn't really identify it.
Right.
And so there were many, but that's where they began to really turn from him, and at the end he says, you know, "There, I've moved here to Tucson and there has been no open doors."
Right, right.
See? And tied that to Jesus standing outside yeah. the door.
You get my tape on marriage and divorce, that up on top of the mountain of Tucson, here not long ago, I was up there praying about it. They dismissed the schools. Watch that pillar of fire circling the mountain and going in a funnel back and forth, up and down. People around here knows it. There and saw it. And it, when he told me the truth of this marriage and divorce, questions, if there's one side going this way and one going that way, there's got to be a truth somewhere. And after those seven seals, he showed what was the truth of it. This is to my church only, not my church, the little flock that believes me and follows me. This is to them. The other day, knowing that when I tell you anything, it must come, "Thus saith the Lord." Then I had the Scriptures as He revealed it to me. But Lord God, what can I say to that congregation? I'll have separations. Man will be steady on the porch and out in the yard and everywhere else. Shall I leave her? Women, shall I leave my husband? What shall I do? I said, "Lord, what can I do?" Something said to me, "Go up yonder in the mountain. I'll talk to you." And while I was up in the mountain, not knowing that down in Tucson, they were seeing. But even the teachers called the children from my little girl in there, from the schoolroom, and said, "Look yonder in that mountain. There's a fiery looking amber cloud going up in the air and coming back down, going up in the air and coming back down." Miss Evans, are you here? Ronnie, are you here? I come on back down to the station, this young boy by the filling station, the Evans filling station there. And before I know what the boy was going to say, he tucked me on my feet. He said, "Brother Branham, you was up in that mountain over yonder, wasn't you?" I said, "What do you mean, Ronnie?" "No." See, to see what he was going to do. A lot of times things happen, you don't say it to people. It becomes the thing of
The Apostle Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 12:7, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation that was given to me, a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure." Brother Branham was bothered by a severe stomach ailment that would return to him every 7 years, and 1965 was the next year for this unpleasant illness. In September of that year, God declared through a vision that the squirrel-like animal that represented what was inside tearing up his stomach was only 6 inches long. That meant it would affect him only 6 times. The 7th time should have come sometime later that same year. However, on September 20th, 1965, a voice spoke to Brother Branham saying, "Go to the Catalina Mountains." When he climbed the trail, he found a dead squirrel-like animal impaled on a cactus. It looked exactly like the one he had seen in the vision. Then the voice of the Lord declared, "Your enemy is dead." The following day, the prophet made 2 striking discoveries.
When Brother Branham was here, he tells on tape that he was bare-chested, right? He didn't have a shirt on, and he was hiking, and he got hot. And he leaned against the rock like this because the rocks are cool. So he's cooling himself on the rock. And a voice spoke to him and said, "What are you leaning against?" And he pushed himself back. And right here was the word eagle. Somewhere here. Now, eagle. And then he looks up and he sees that eagle rock.
That morning I got up after seeing this vision. Obeyed the Lord. I took my little boy Joseph to school. He's listening to me now in Tucson. I took him to school, told me that I didn't know when I'd be back. And I took off up into Catalina, up into the foothills. And I went up into the place where the angel of the Lord put the sword in my hand real early. And started climbing up the mountain. Well, instead of going up in the peaks this way, which is a lot of snakes, scorpions, you know how Arizona is, I turned to my right. Something said, "Turn to your right." I went way into the peaks. I went around, and I was going around those great, huge rocks, many times bigger than this tabernacle, laying up in them tops there where seldom ever a person could get. Along about 11 o'clock, I was going into a little cove, backwards, a little place turned in like this, over a little deer trail. And I had my shirt off, my hat in my hand, because I was just lathering with sweat. And so I turned in there, and as I turned in that little cove, I felt the presence of the Lord. I jerked off my hat and looked around. "Oh, he's here somewhere. I know he's here. Oh, what is it?" I made a few more steps. I said, "Lord, you're here somewhere." I looked laying on the path, and there laid that little squirrel, had jumped at something and missed it. And it hit a bunch of cholla, that's jumping cactus. It ran through his head, chest, stomach, and he was dead. That odd-looking little squirrel, he had missed my mouth and hit that cholla. And the voice of the Lord said, "Your enemy is dead." I stood there, I trembled. I took my foot back. Usually crows would eat it up. I killed him. Snake, a couple days later, laid on the road about a half hour. There's always eagles and crows flying through there. They'll pick it up right now. I killed a coral snake. That's the most dangerous snake we got. Laying right beside me a few days after that. I started to come back to pick it up to show it. Crows had done got it. Ravens passing over. And that had been laying there ever since I'd seen the vision 2 days before. It was on Saturday and I went up there on Monday. So there he was laying on there dead. I mashed it with a foot. I went back around, sat down again, sat there and cried a while and prayed, looking down over Tucson, miles below me. Turned back around and come back and still laid there. When I entered that cold, the Spirit of God come on me again. I went all around, went down the mountain, went in and told my wife, I said, "Honey, I don't know how, but I'm going to get over this." Dr. Ravensworth, when he gave me the examination, he said, "It's totally impossible for you to be well." He gave me a shot of pentothal that was to last me for 5 minutes, and I slept 10 hours. So that stuff, and even an aspirin just knocks me out. So he gave me a shot, put that tube down the throat, When I come to it, he told me next morning, he said, Reverend, I hate to tell you this, but said your stomach walls are even so hard they're dried up. I never seen it. He used the name of gastritis, and I went and looked in the dictionary, and it said something is withered away. It said you can't get over it. It said you'll always have it. And I would have been a discouraged boy if it hadn't been for the vision of the Lord. And the next day, something said, go back to the mountain. And that day, instead of going one way, I was led to go another way. And I was standing there. And looking, sitting in front of me. And there sat that seventh little white dove. Looking right at me. I rubbed my eyes. I said, surely it's a vision. Surely it is. I looked and I said, little dove, where do you come from? Just as pretty and white. Could have been a pigeon. Whatever it was away in that wilderness. God Almighty, who raised up Jesus Christ from the dead, whose servant I am, his word laid here open before me. Know that I tell the truth and lie not. There sat the dove, sitting there looking at me. I walked around, I thought, surely it's a vision. I turned my head, looked back, and there he sat there, them little white wings, just as snowy as he could be, his little yellow feet and little yellow beak, sitting there looking at me, he's watching right straight westward. I walked around him like I wouldn't touch him for nothing. I walked on up the trail, looked back, and there he still sat watching me. Brother, as a son of Abraham, I consider not what the doctor told me. I'm going to be well anyhow. The third day I went back, I was climbing up high. Many of you know the vision about the Indian chief riding that little wall to the west. Something attracted me all to a big rock. About noontime, said, lay your hands against that and pray. God in heaven knows this is truth. I laid my hands against the rock and looked up towards heaven and started praying. I heard a voice coming out of the top of the rock there. Said, what are you leaning against over your heart? I raised back like this, my bare shoulders naked from the waist up, hot. I looked back, and there was wrote in the quartz, in the stone, white eagle. Just exactly what the vision said that the next message would come forth by. I was so excited, I run home, got a camera, and come back the next day and took the picture of it. It was still there. Wrote in the rock. White eagle. Dove leading eagle. Somehow, I know, I tell you before it happens, the doctor's a good doctor, no doubt. I think he's a fine man. But I know I'm going to be over it. It's done. It's finished. And I'm going to be well. I was thinking as Ernie sang that song a few moments ago, on the wings of a dove. How is the melody to that? Start it for me, Ernie. Thank you.
Only a few days before his departure from this dimension, Brother Branham preached his final service, communion, December 12, 1965, at the Tucson Tabernacle, while yet in its first location. The building was originally the first Jewish temple in Arizona, called the Stone Avenue Temple, or Temple Emmanuel. It was incorporated March 20, 1910. It currently houses the Jewish Heritage Center of the Southwest. Standing in front of the church, Brother Branham was watching a Veterans Day parade, and as the band passed by the church, the music changed to Onward Christian Soldiers. What could this mean? That same day, the pastor of the Downtown Assembly of God decided to close his church. Brother Perry was able to rent the building. The temple had served its purpose. It was indeed time to move onward, Christian soldiers. Both Jesus and Brother Branham preached their last public sermons in Jewish temples, closing out an era. In the time of Jesus, the gospel light was to transfer to the Gentiles. Simeon had said over the Christ child, "Lord, now let us thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel." Brother Branham's ministry was to restore the heart of these Gentile children back to the original apostolic Pentecostal fathers. Soon, the gospel light will shift from the Gentiles and return to the Jews.
You see, there was no church in Tucson when I came here.
Right.
Brother Branham had asked some other brothers to start them, but they would not, because they wanted Brother Branham to say, this is to do this, do this. But when Brother Branham came to this city, per the directions of the Lord, he met with the 10 full gospel pastors in this city. Assemblies of God, Oneness. He had a breakfast with them, or a meeting or somewhere. I wasn't here. And they were concerned about him coming to the city, because if he came here and started one, they knew that he would empty their churches. Because Brother Branham couldn't even go to church with his family. Because if he went, there would be 200 or 300 people who were here in the city for Brother Branham to pray for him. And if they were to find out he was going to go to a Methodist church, they'd go there 5 o'clock in the morning and be waiting when the deacons got there to unlock the door, and they'd just go and fill up the church, and they would interrupt their program. So Brother Branham, if he went to church, he had to slip off. He had to secretly take his family and go somewhere to church. Brother Branham was a pleasure to preach to, because he knew how to say amen. And you're sitting there, and I felt like Paul preaching to Jesus. Or, you know, it's just, you don't know what to do, but I was doing it because he told me to. He told Sister Branham, whenever I came back from breakfast with him one time, that Brother Green's coming to town and he's going to start us a church. He's the kind of guy that'll get the job done. And the secret is that I found the building without Brother Branham telling me. Now, he said that the other brothers, the reason they wouldn't start one is because they would find a building and they'd come and say, "Brother Branham, is this where we're supposed to be?" Well, he had told the pastors in this city he wouldn't start a church. That's the reason on the tapes from Shreveport, he says, "I didn't start the church in Tucson. Brother Green did." Brother Branham had to do that to keep his word to the pastors in his city. But you see, if you want to be negative about it, you can say, "Well, Brother Green said that. Brother Branham said that wasn't his church. He didn't start that church." It's just according to your mental attitude about it. Yeah. But I took it because Brother Branham told me I followed the leadership of the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to tell you this, any time you do what the Spirit of God tells you to do, there's going to be opposition to it. And not going to be everybody's not going to agree with you. So that was the start of Tucson Tabernacle. But that Sunday, when Brother Branham talked about it, he said, "We'll be in this building, and when I grow it, we'll go to another one, we'll move to another one, and then maybe by that time, the Lord will come."
You got to assemble ourselves together to worship God. Amen. The Bible said so. When we see this day approaching, that much more come together. If there's only two people here, you be one of them. Now that, and if we come together and worship together, then we just, something or other about it. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. Now, as I said before, Brother Green told me, and he said it, my wife come told me what he said when I was away, that he said this morning, the pulpit was open at any time. Now, usually, that's open for me to speak. Now, usually, I had to drive all the way to Jeffersonville, Indiana, to give a message that God gave me. Amen. To bring it to the people, go all the way to Jeffersonville, Indiana, and each one of you stringing across the country and hooking up the wires and things to get the message, because that's what we're living on. That's what we're here for. Well, we don't have to do that anymore. God gives me a message, I can walk right here to the pulpit and preach it and feel free to do it. And I believe by that, that God Almighty will bless you if you will just stand by this church, this group of people. Not only that, but let's go out and see if we can't get others to come in. See? Let's speak to others everywhere. Speak to them about our church and what it means. But our church, we're here, we want you to come, bring in strangers. I'm sure it'll be good for all of us. See, we have a building which we're thankful for. We're thankful for this place together, together. But high be it, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands. See, for heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool, and where is the place of my rest? But a body has thou prepared me. And we are a body of Christ. So as we move from one building to another building, I believe, and bring in our messages, and we'll come down and have healing services, and anything the Lord reveals to us to do, we'll have it right here in the church until it swells out so big we have to take it somewhere else and somewhere else until Jesus comes.
Amen.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Dear God, as we stand here on this platform which represents right over the altar here, we realize that we are a dying race of people as far as this earth is concerned. We look out upon the streets and see sin wrote everywhere. And that the glory of the Lord is swiftly departing. We know when the glory of the Lord goes up, so will the church go with it. God, we want to be there. Just a few days ago, standing here on the streetcar, just across the street, watching that parade go down the street, and seeing those old First War tanks leading the way. Then come the big heavy Sherman tank. Behind that followed on and on and on. Then the Gold Star Mothers. The little broke-up family with a crying wife and a little ragged boy had lost his daddy. An old mother had lost a son. Oh, how sad to stand on a street corner and watch something like that pass. And then noticing just as they passed this building, the music changed to Armored Christian Soldiers, playing their marches behind, but when they passed this spot. Dear God, I'm thinking of another great time coming, and that would be the resurrection, when the old-timers will come forth first, saints and patriarchs. For we which are alive and remain shall not prevent or hinder those which are asleep. For the trumpet of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then when we see that great list of people going marching up through the skies, and we be standing waiting for our change, knowing that we'll fall in line also. God, make us faithful soldiers. Only those who have really associated and been in the war to know what that really meant to see those tanks rolling by. God, we thank those who've been in the battle of life will know what it means when we're waiting our turn to fall in position and place in the resurrection to go up. Now, my text for this morning is a odd word, shalom. Shalom in the Hebrew means peace. And that's what I say to the church this morning, shalom. That's peace. In Finnish it's called Jumalan Raha, which means God's peace upon you. Raha, God. See? God's peace. Shalom. A New Year's message is to the church elected in Jesus Christ for 1964. Not just the church groups, but the elect, the lady of the church, Christ's bride. See, that's who I'm addressing. We're facing here in our two subjects that we read, the two scriptures rather, very contrast one to the other. In Isaiah it says, rise and shine, for the glory of God has come upon you, the light is here. And then the very next verse he says, gross darkness is upon this people. And then when we are in a mixture of light and darkness, and then my address to the church is shalom, peace. Let's find out what it's all about. See? We are facing this year with both darkness and light. The world is in one of the most chaotic times of darkness that it's ever stood in. And yet it's standing in, again, the most blessed light that ever shined in. Thank you.
Only a few days before his departure from this dimension, Brother Branham preached his final service, Communion, December 12, 1965, at the Tucson Tabernacle, while yet in its first location. The building was originally the first Jewish temple in Arizona, called the Stone Avenue Temple, or Temple Emmanuel. It was incorporated March 20, 1910. It currently houses the Jewish Heritage Center of the Southwest. Standing in front of the church, Brother Branham was watching a Veterans Day parade, and as the band passed by the church, the music changed to Onward Christian Soldiers. What could this mean? That same day, the pastor of the Downtown Assembly of God decided to close his church. Brother Perry was able to rent the building. The temple had served its purpose. It was indeed time to move onward, Christian soldiers. Both Jesus and Brother Branham preached their last public sermons in Jewish temples, closing out an era. In the time of Jesus, the gospel light was to transfer to the Gentiles. Simeon had said over the Christ child, "Lord, now lettest thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel." Brother Branham's ministry was to restore the heart of these Gentile children back to the original apostolic Pentecostal fathers. Soon, the gospel light will shift from the Gentiles and return to the Jews.
You see, there was no church in Tucson when I came here.
Right.
Brother Branham had asked some other brothers to start them, but they would not, because they wanted Brother Branham to say, this is to do this, do this. But when Brother Branham came to this city, per the directions of the Lord, he met with the 10 full gospel pastors in this city. Assemblies of God, Oneness. He had a breakfast with them, or a meeting or somewhere. I wasn't here. And they were concerned about him coming to the city, because if he came here and started one, they knew that he would empty their churches. Because Brother Branham couldn't even go to church with his family. Because if he went, there would be 200 or 300 people who were here in the city for Brother Branham to pray for him. And if they were to find out he was going to go to a Methodist church, they'd go there 5 o'clock in the morning and be waiting when the deacons got there to unlock the door, and they'd just go and fill up the church, and they would interrupt their program. So Brother Branham, if he went to church, he had to slip off. He had to secretly take his family and go somewhere to church. Brother Branham was a pleasure to preach to, because he knew how to say amen. And you're sitting there, and I felt like Paul preaching to Jesus. You don't know what to do, but I was doing it because he told me to. He told Sister Branham, whenever I came back from breakfast with him one time, that Brother Green's coming to town and he's going to start us a church. He's the kind of guy that'll get the job done. And the secret is that I found the building without Brother Branham telling me. Now, he said that the other brothers, the reason they wouldn't start one is because they would find a building and they'd come and say, "Brother Branham, is this where we're supposed to be?" Well, he had told the pastors in this city he wouldn't start a church. That's the reason on the tapes from Shreveport, he says, "I didn't start the church in Tucson. Brother Green did." Brother Branham had to do that to keep his word to the pastors in his city. But you see, if you want to be negative about it, you can say, "Well, Brother Green said that. Brother Branham said that wasn't his church. He didn't start that church." It's just according to your mental attitude about it. Yeah. But I took it because Brother Branham told me I followed the leadership of the Holy Ghost. Yeah. And I'm going to tell you this: anytime you do what the Spirit of God tells you to do, there's going to be opposition to it. And they're not going to be everybody's not going to agree with you. So that was the start of Tucson Tabernacle. But that Sunday, when Brother Branham talked about it, he said, "We'll be in this building, and when I grow up, we'll go to another one, we'll move to another one, and then maybe by that time, the Lord will come."
You got to assemble ourselves together to worship God.
Amen.
The Bible said so. When we see this day approaching, that much more come together. If there's only two people here, you be one of them. Now that, and if we come together and worship together, then we just, something or another about it. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. Now, as I said before, Brother Green told me, and he said it, my wife come told me what he said when I was away, that he said this morning, the pulpit was open at any time. Now, usually, that's open for me to speak. Now, usually, I had to drive all the way to Jeffersonville, Indiana, to give a message that God gave me.
Amen.
To bring it to the people, go all the way to Jeffersonville, Indiana, and each one of you stringing across the country and hooking up the wires and things to get the message, because that's what we're living on. That's what we're here for. Well, we don't have to do that anymore. God gives me a message, I can walk right here to the pulpit and preach it and feel free to do it. And I believe by that, that God Almighty will bless you if you will just stand by this church now, this group of people. Not only that, but let's go out and see if we can't get others to come in. See? Let's speak to others everywhere. Speak to them about our church and what it means. But our church, we're here, we want you to come, bring in strangers. I'm sure it'll be good for all of us. See, we have a building which we're thankful for. We're thankful for this place together. But howbeit, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands. See, for heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool, and where is the place of my rest? But a body has thou prepared me. And we are a body of Christ. So as we move from one building to another building, I believe, and bringing our messages, and we'll come down and have healing services, and anything the Lord reveals to us to do, we'll have it right here in the church until it swells out so big we have to take it somewhere else and somewhere else until Jesus comes.
Amen.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Dear God, as we stand here on this platform which represents right over the altar here, we realize that we are a dying race of people as far as this earth is concerned. We look out upon the streets and see sin wrote everywhere. And that the glory of the Lord is swiftly departing. We know when the glory of the Lord goes up, so will the church go with it. God, we want to be there. Just a few days ago, standing here on the streetcar, just across the street, watching that parade go down the street, and seeing those old First War tanks leading the way. Then come the big heavy Sherman tank. Behind that followed on and on and on. Then the Gold Star mothers, the little broke-up family with a crying wife and a little ragged boy had lost his daddy. An old mother had lost a son. Oh, how sad to stand on a street corner and watch something like that pass. And then noticing just as they passed this building, the music changed to Onward Christian Soldiers, playing their marches behind, but when they passed this spot, dear God, I'm thinking of another great time coming, and that would be the resurrection, when the old timers will come forth first, saints and patriarchs, for we which are alive and remain shall not prevent or hinder those which are asleep, for the trumpet of God shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then when we see that great list of people going marching up through the skies, and we be standing waiting for our change, knowing that we'll fall in line also. God, make us faithful soldiers. Only those who have really associated and been in the war to know what that really meant to see those tanks rolling by. God, we thank those who've been in the battle of life will know what it means when we're waiting our turn to fall in position and place in the resurrection to go up. Now, my text for this morning is an odd word, shalom. Shalom in the Hebrew means peace. And that's what I say to the church this morning, shalom. That's peace. In Finnish it's called Jumalan Raha, which means God's peace upon you. Raha, God. See? God's peace. Shalom. My New Year's message is to the church elected in Jesus Christ for 1964. Not just the church groups, but the elect, the lady of the church, Christ's bride. See, that's who I'm addressing. We're facing here in our two subjects that we read, the two scriptures rather, very contrast one to the other. In Isaiah it says, rise and shine, for the glory of God has come upon you, the light is here. And then the very next verse he says, gross darkness is upon this people. And then when we are in a mixture of light and darkness, and then my address to the church is shalom, peace. Let's find out what's all about. See? We are facing this year with both darkness and light. The world is in one of the most chaotic times of darkness that it's ever stood in, and yet it's standing in again the most blessed light that it ever shined in.